agenda is approval of the summary minutes from February 2nd, 2010.
I'll move that we approve those minutes.
Second.
Was there a change that needed to be?
Yeah.
Oh.
We had somebody present who wasn't really here, so we need to change the minutes to reflect that.
With that.
Is there anybody else that we showed being here that wasn't?
All of us.
In body.
And you meant to include that?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Been moved and seconded to approve the minutes of the February 2nd, 2010 meeting with the notation that Commissioner Soderberg was not here. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None being heard, motion carries. Item number two and number three, since they are of a same nature, we will merge together on Dean's request. Dean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What we have here is we've got a three-part application. We have an application that involves the requested rezoning of a piece of property that's currently outside the city limits, the requested annexation of that property, and a proposed preliminary plat for that property. The rezoning was advertised for a public hearing, and it would be appropriate to have that discussion here this afternoon to focus on the zoning and land use. The plat has a little catching up to do, but our John, we're on Stone Lake Edition over there, far right side. Well, the property that we're talking about is at the location of the northeast corner of Ohio Street and Schilling Road. And it's popping up on the screen here for you now. So to get your bearings, this is Schilling Road. You have underneath this black square a sand pit known as Alsop Sand Pit. To the east of it is a sand pit, the Johnson Sand Pit. And then there is a sand pit over here, also Johnson Sand, that's on the other side of the levee. This is Liberty Edition here. This is Quail Meadows Estates here. This is property owned by Stan Byquist here that has the Knox Sand Pit in it. This little trapezoid here is actually Stan Byquist's home site. And then this is the sand pit. This is the existing city limit line, which goes along the east side of Ohio. So we have property that's outside the city limits. And John, if you could go to the proposed zoning, item two. And you may have to magnify it a little bit. The request here is predominantly, you have this in your packet, but again, it's hard to read, so we've got to blow it up. This is a proposal for C5 zoning right here at the corner. This shading here represents a request for C3 shopping center zoning. This is a request, this pattern here represents R2.5 or multifamily zoning. This shading down here, extending here and to this area here, represents R2.5 single family zoning, and all the rest of this pattern here is single family residential. So I don't know if you had any luck zooming in on any of those areas, John, if you could get it to 120% or something. But again, this would be Schilling Road here, Ohio here. This is referred to as Shoreline Drive in various reports. This is Crystal Lake Drive right here. And again, Ohio Street here with Mr. Byquist's property to the north. And then it's difficult to see, but right here, more or less with the street pattern laid over it, is the Interceptor sewer line. that runs through this property and then on to the north. So the request here is to have a mixed-use subdivision with commercial primarily along the Ohio Street frontage, and then with single-family and multifamily intermixed. And on the annexation side, the request then is to take this whole 150-acre site and bring it into the city. And if you go back to number one, John, you can again see that this is contiguous to the city right here. And this is not in the city today, but we would be physically attached and extending in that direction. John, if you have my the zoning discussion points that you could call up. We have about six land use items that we would want to go over with you and give feedback both to staff and the applicant on. And one of those is the fact that as it stands now, we have a request for straight C5 zoning, or a proposal for C5 zoning there at the very corner. And at the southwest corner, which is Liberty Edition, and the northwest quarter, which is Quail Meadow Estates, the Planning Commission recommended approval of Plan C5 zoning for those corners, but with the deletion of certain undesirable uses from the list of permitted uses, and also required that that Planning Commission review and approval of future site plans occur. So one question there is whether that should apply to Stone Lake as well. And so that's one thing we want to discuss with you. The approach that was taken there was that in the case of Liberty Edition, the developers there looked at the list of C5 uses and said, well, we don't want to have contractors' yards, we don't want to have used car lots, we don't want to have these particular things at this location. So those were deleted from the approved district. That's one approach that you could take. I don't know, John, do you have the drawing, this overall site plan drawing for Quail Meadows, or is this acting up too much to go back and forth?
One moment.
It would be under the 07-10, John. For some reason, this is really being bulky today. And it would be the next slide, I think, John. This is what the Planning Commission received. This is Ohio. This is the corner here where they're asking for the C5 zoning. This tract here is C5. And then this is Plan C2. But what was done here was that this was C5, subject to a final plan being approved by the Planning Commission, as well as a pretty hefty list of C5 uses, like contractor yards and used car lots and things like that, being deleted. So that is one discussion point. The other discussion point is that this right here is planned C2, which is a neighborhood shopping district. One of the characteristics of C2 as opposed to C3 is in C2, the largest building that you can build is 25,000 square feet. And so C2 is designed to have shopping or commercial services at a neighborhood scale. And so one question is whether the C3 or C2 is a more appropriate fit for the lots along Ohio Street. And then, John, if you could, I know we're jumping back and forth at item two, or drawing two there, left-hand side right here, if you could get us back to that one on Stone Lake. Okay, one third question would be, this is Stone Lake, or Shoreline Drive here. This is shown as proposed commercial here and then transitioning to residential. One question is whether this street right here should serve as cutoff for commercial, or if you do have commercial north, what kind of transitions would you have between the commercial and any housing to the north of it? It's a little easier to have buffers and transitions if the street is your break, but this is proposed as commercial as well. And then a follow-up question to that is, if this is housing here and this is commercial here, which direction should any commercial be required to face? Would you want to have the front door and the frontage facing Ohio, even though access is limited? Or should, with this being housing, should the front of the businesses be oriented here? You're going to have limited access here, so some of the commercial traffic would come and enter here anyway. And I guess if you visualize where Applebee's and Red Lobster is on 9th Street, there are no individual driveways on 9th Street for Applebee's or Red Lobster. You access it from Marketplace on the other side, and they designed those buildings so that the front door of Applebee's, so to speak, faces 9th Street and the back backs up to the street. Logan's Roadhouse did that, except that was an interstate and they backed up to Riffle Drive. But if there was some feedback on what the orientation should be here. And then this is just an observation to maybe change the character, but these are more standard or modest size lots in the R1 category. These are larger estate type lots that are much deeper. And one question we had is whether the primary difference between R and R1 is that the R1 requires a 25-foot setback from a street. The R requires a minimum 30-foot. And to distinguish this area, we thought some consideration should be given to having that larger lots have the R zoning with the 30-foot setback. And then a final question would be how this development ties in with the ownership and operation of the lake, and whether with common area, this area here should be done as a planned development district. But some of that will relate to that. An additional question that's not land use but is a connectivity question, you have at your place a letter from Stan Byquist. And what he is requesting is that consideration be given for some type of connection right here. The sewer interceptor extends on up into his property, and he is requesting that some consideration be done for an extension there. And so you will hear from the applicants a little bit about the question of connectivity and having a self-contained community. And I think if you think about it yourself, you will see some neighborhoods that are interconnected, and you'll see other neighborhoods like Red Fox Lane where they're not interconnected. So you would need to think about it from that standpoint. And John, I think drawing number 5 there is a conceptual layout. And if to orient this is directly north of Stone Lake. This is Ohio. This is the Knox Sand Pit. And this is the sewer interceptor here. What Mr. Byquist is requesting consideration as if you brought some connection here, that would provide a interconnection with his property. I don't know, do we have the ArcGIS, John, where we could go to an aerial photo?
It would take a moment to pull that up.
Okay. One of the considerations that goes into that interconnectivity is to have interconnection between subdivisions where you don't have to go out to a major arterial street to get a connection. So if you would visualize River Trail, which is east of Golden Eagle and east of the Huntington Ditch, that's in the Stewart Elementary School District. And because of interconnectivity between subdivisions over there, a child could bicycle from River Trail, get over to Stewart School without ever having to go out to Magnolia Road. But if those subdivisions weren't connected, then everybody entering and exiting those subdivisions would have to do it at Magnolia Road. Well, what I was going to have John call up with the aerial photo, and Mr. Kennedy is aware of this, and the school district may or may not pursue it, but there is a piece of property that the school district owns that is directly east of Eastview Estates. And most likely, if there was a new school built in that location, that's where children would go if they were in this area. But the school site is right here, and we got a ditch here. So even if you had a connection right at this point, which is where Mr. Byquist is asking for it, you would still have difficulty getting to this site, although you might be able to do, Mr. Stack's done pedestrian bridges before. We have one out at Schilling Elementary that's one of our favorites, but that is a possibility. But this is an elementary school site, and so options would be leave it as it is proposed, where you come out here and get on this trail along Ohio Street or the street itself, or that you have a pedestrian connection right here for bicycles and pedestrians, or you have a full street connection there. So we've identified some zoning discussion points or land use discussion points, the whether we do a plan C5 and delete some of the C5 uses, whether C3 or C2 is better fit for those lots along Ohio, whether commercial zoning should extend north of Shoreline Drive, and what orientation should commercial development have between Ohio and Crystal Lake Drive, the appropriate zoning for the single family area, and then whether the townhome around the lake should be done as a PDD. And we bring that up primarily because in most of the cases where we have a subdivision that has common area, you've got a homeowners association, you've got a number of things, and that generally works best in a planned development district context where you've got a drawing recorded that ties back to the homeowners association documents and covenants. But again, this is a request to rezone and annex the property, and the appropriate thing today would be to provide some feedback to staff and the applicant on those land use items and the connectivity questions, so as they move forward with the actual plat document, that we'd be able to take those things into account. So I think with that, I would take questions on the zoning or annexation or what was contained in Mr. Byquist's letter there. Then we should probably hear from the applicant, and then any feedback that you have about those points.
Questions of staff?
You made the comment that because if this were adopted, that would give commercial development on three of those four corners, and that we would assume that we would not want commercial development on that fourth corner?
I don't think that's necessarily the case. What the the draft comprehensive plan calls for is they're calling this a neighborhood center. And a neighborhood center, it would generally be predominantly commercial with some forms of residential intermixed. And that's what they've done here with multifamily and here with multifamily. And so this right here is the true mixed use portion of that. The issues at the southeast corner have more to do with the availability of utilities and whether it's even feasible to develop that in the city as it is today, because of the way the layout works is that the water comes down the west side of Ohio and goes that way. The interceptor is up here, and as you get farther south, it becomes more of a challenge to get sewer service to get into that interceptor. So it is both a land use question and also whether it's even feasible to develop the southeast corner with city services anytime in the near future. But if you look at Iron in Ohio or 9th and Crawford or things like that, it's not unusual to have all four corners being the same. And we've got two out of four with Plan C5 and a C5 proposed here. And so that's, for us, it was more a question of whether, not if C5, but whether Plan C5 with some modifications.
I guess when I first looked at this, I was concerned about the number of lots or the potential number of people living there, and the first time I looked at it, I only saw the one access point, but there is one at the south there. Is that correct?
Well, what's being discussed here is in the initial stages an emergency access point that would be reserved for a public street at such time as Schilling Road were upgraded to city standards. Right now you wouldn't want to introduce all the subdivision traffic onto Schilling Road unless it were upgraded to city standards. And this is the classic case where you have property on the north side ready to develop and property on the south side not ready to develop, and one side in the city and one side out of the city. So it would not be easy to do a paving project on Schilling Road. So what they're asking for is the primary entrance here, and then this becomes a secondary emergency point of access if you should have some kind of accident or blockage here.
I guess I'd like to hear Mr. Stack's thoughts on the safety issues regarding the potential number of people living there and emergency.
Okay. We have talked with them about emergency access on the south. We definitely need two accesses for sure. So I guess we'd have to see what kind of trip generation this whole thing would include and see if that warrants another entrance. So that's something we haven't done yet. This is preliminary, so we're wanting to see if they're going to have an entrance or a connectivity to the north as well. And so that all those things have an impact on whether or not we need another one on Ohio or Schilling. So we could, that's a good question, though.
Mm-hmm. What's kind of the rule of thumb already for a transition from commercial like they have north of that road? What's kind of a rule? I remember there's some fencing rules, but what is it for what's that going to be, C4, what did you say?
If it's either C2 or C3, if it C3. Was some sort of retail or commercial, I guess the best example, we have two pretty good examples. One is the Green Lantern car wash at 9th and Crawford. We're on the south side. There's a good 15-foot buffer and a fence. And also up at where you have it's called Countryside Plaza, where Papa John's is, that's got some housing directly to the north of it. Mm-hmm. And it has a 15-foot landscape buffer there and fencing, and that seems to have worked pretty well as a buffer. So if this were approved for commercial north of this street, and you had housing here, you'd be looking at a minimum 15-foot wide landscape buffer strip and then probably some sort of fence along that common property line here. So the 15-foot buffer is for distance, light and sound, and then the fence is more for privacy.
Okay. Any further questions of staff? Would the applicant care to address the commission? Name and address, please.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Jim Mays with Compro Realty, 157 South 7th. To kind of give you an idea of the concept that we're trying to create here, we're trying to create a residential community. We want one entrance in and out if possible. The entrance is an extra wide entrance. There'll be a right-hand turn, left-hand turn out of the facility, one in. But this is going to be a planned development that is controlled by covenants. We are going to have a covenant that allows everybody in the community to have access to a common area on the lake itself. Their vision is that we're going to have a bathhouse, a pool, beachfront. There's going to be playgrounds in the community itself. So we're not wanting to open up a lot of accesses so the general public will become a nuisance in the community. We have control of the type of housing that goes in, the square footage, the design, things such as that. You see it a lot in the major communities. As far as the zoning, this is a little premature because staff had reviewed this. We've already made some zoning changes in it. If you don't mind, I'll go over to the map and show you what we're proposing.
In the area north of the street, we're going to bring the residential zoning down to the very first lot. We'll make that C1, which is more office type development, which we think fits better than putting a resident right on that business corner. Then we're going to take C2 down to three lots here, and then the remaining C3. These will be C2. One of the reasons we didn't go to plan development district, these are small lots, and we didn't want to have to come back 12 times to get a plan reviewed. They're going to be single owner developments. You know, you're not going to see multiple buildings on each one of these lots. So as far as the residential development on the lake itself and whether that be planned development, again, we made those small lots. Our anticipation in the market's going to show us what direction this is going to go, but what we're planning on doing is taking those lots and selling them to an individual to build a duplex townhome on, or a developer to build each individual lot out. So there'll be separate ownership divided out by the lots.
On which lots are you talking about? The Ohio lots? Right here, oh, the Ohio lots.
No, only. The lots on the lake in the southwest corner.
Ah. Yeah, our question is whether if this was going to be built all at once with a unified theme or whatever, and it was tied in with the lake, whether that would or should be done as a planned development district. And what Mr. Mays is saying is that this lot, they would all could be sold individually, so they wouldn't necessarily be developed the same, like, you know, Arrowhead townhomes or Manchester Manor, some of the planned developments that we have for townhomes today. And that is an option, to just buy a lot or two lots and put a townhome unit on it today.
And that's what our vision is. If the market changes, we may come back and say we need to do it as a PDD. If we have one developer that wants to do the whole thing. But the concept right now is just individual lots. Now, the lots that ring the lake, as staff has indicated, are large residential lots. And then all of the lots that face the street that rings the lake are larger lots. We try to develop this as three separate pricing structures for residential on in the whole subdivision. We've had everything from small lots to medium-sized lots to the large estate
lots. These lots here are deeper than these lots here.
Correct. Deeper and normally wider.
Okay. What about the idea of which is the front of the building on Ohio or the commercial?
From Shoreline Drive to the north, we anticipated making that restricted access on Ohio. Everything will enter off of the right. subdivision street. From Shoreline Drive to the south, what our concept was, we were going to share driveways for each lot. But have access, one access per two lots.
But would the
off Ohio Street, I'm
would
sorry.
The public, as they're going down Ohio Street, see the front of the business is on Ohio, or will they be seeing the back of the business?
The front of the business is on Ohio.
But and then the access will be then?
Off of Ohio Street. No, the access will be off Ohio Street for the commercial, but one access per two lots. We're not asking for an access to each one of those lots. Then on the C5 lot, there's a note on the plat, which I'm sure you can't read. We're just showing that I think it's 150 feet back from the corner each direction, that there will be one access point, 45 foot wide. We didn't want to try and tie that down to a very specific spot because we don't know what's going to go in there. But we'll plat it such that the city knows there's only going to be one 45 foot wide in that general area.
There's a couple of school issues with this particular development. One is you realize this would more than likely be a busing area for the middle school. So when it's developed out, you'd have buses to concern yourself with one access morning and afternoon,
of course.
And it would not likely be a busing area for the elementary schools or for the high school the way our current structure is. And secondly, what would your thought be about at least a pedestrian exit on the north side in case we ever did develop school to the north? That's the way students will go. They'll take the closest route, even if it's across somebody's yard. So you better make provisions probably in advance.
We have no problem giving access to Stan Byquist. We'd like it to be an emergency vehicle access, but it can be a pedestrian access.
Thank you.
As well.
Okay.
And that could actually help satisfy kind of what your concern is as well with the secondary exit. Yeah, that would help.
And we made the major exit two lanes out, so to help that.
Two out, two in.
Yeah. Two out, one in.
Oh, one in. Okay. One in, two out. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And I think it's important to point out, and we didn't share it because we're not discussing the plat yet, but this is going to be developed in phases, obviously, with this many lots to absorb. And so what we would work with, if you had the north area also available for emergency access, that would allow them to phase and get that emergency access incorporated depending on which direction you go with your phasing.
The phasing has been laid out and the city's reviewing it. Okay. How we're going to phase it in.
And you wouldn't have any problems with scaling down the C5 as we did on the other intersections, the uses?
The C5 is just the very corner.
Right.
And that's a fairly small lot. It's basically, I think it's 300 foot square. So we really don't want to scale that down because you lose the ability to put most commercial uses on.
I think what she's talking about is the permitted uses in that C5. In other words, paring those down, taking some of the ones out of there, say,
tattoo parlors.
The other option for dealing with that, since they are going to have covenants, you know, that deal with the rest of the subdivision, if you know, if they in their own minds want to protect the other business lots there or whatever by ruling certain things out privately in their covenants, that is a method for doing that. Obviously, they're going to be sharing their covenants with city staff, and we'll be reviewing those. But if they wanted to stay out of using the zoning ordinance to delete uses and have them restrict it through covenants, that's another approach that could be taken.
And that's the approach we anticipate.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to do the restriction with the covenant, just like we're doing on the residential lots.
Hard to estimate, but what do you think, what are you gunning for that corner? I mean, are you seeing that as a gas station, or are you seeing that as a restaurant, or what are you thinking?
At this point in time,
nothing.
It's very hard to say.
Okay.
You know, with Stan's development across the street, Stan has the large commercial development.
Mm-hmm.
This is
mm-hmm.
going to be just mirrored off of that large development, whatever shows up.
Okay.
So.
How are covenants reviewed then when something comes into the planning department for building plans? And I'm just, it seems clearer to me that if you have before you the uses that have been restricted for C5 than a covenant governing that, but I don't know that to
yeah.
be part of the process.
I mean, that is, and Jim can probably speak to that better than myself, but if I recall correctly, when the piece of property that was sold for where Taco Bell is today, was that owned by Blue Beacon, and was that sold with a covenant that you couldn't put a gasoline service station there?
Correct.
So that's the type of thing that I'm referring to. The difference is that when we review covenants from the city's perspective, if somebody has a private street or they have common area or they have a pond or lake, we're reviewing it to make sure that there is a responsible entity to take care of those things. We're not, if they have a covenant that says every house has to have 1,500 square feet and somebody brings in a permit for a 1,200 square foot house and it meets all the zoning requirements, we are going to issue that permit. So if everyone agrees, but it's not put in the ordinance, that we don't want a used car lot at the corner of Schilling and Ohio at that corner, if it's not addressed through zoning, then it would need to be addressed through covenants. We would expect either that A, they wouldn't sell a piece of property to someone who wanted to put in a car lot, or B, if we were going to issue a permit for a building that was for a used car lot, that they would block that or put a stop to it. But the primary difference is that the city does not enforce covenants as a general rule. That's up to the developer to do that, and you just have to believe that the developer is going to do what's in their best interest.
And in 15 years, I mean, that's the thing that I see as a problem, that you sell it as one thing at some point and it abides by the covenant, and then in 15 years that's sold again and it becomes something else that would not have been permitted.
And that will be up to them, is how they see the phasing, and how they, I've seen covenants that last for 40 years, I've seen covenants that last for 100 years, I've seen covenants that last for 15 years. You know, if you think that the development's going to be longer term, then you put a longer life on the covenants.
These covenants are 20 years and renew automatically. Every homeowner, this is going to be a homeowners association, every homeowner has a right to enforce the covenants. So every lot that's sold in there, they can enforce that that corner stays with whatever we outline in the covenants. The only way they can be changed is by 2/3 vote of all the property owners.
And if that happens, then whatever our understanding with you, what those initial covenants were, essentially goes out the window.
If two-thirds of the homeowners vote to change the covenant and change what the restriction is on that corner, yes.
It's just,
but that's all the homeowners, and that's all the people that are going to be affected by it. So they don't normally change things that will have a detriment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, except it's my experience that covenants, at some point, people, you know, start forgetting, and somebody who initially bought the house understanding completely what the covenants are, then the third person in that house, the third homeowner, that becomes more unclear, and I don't know, it just, the covenant, for that corner, because we have been rigorous on the other corners. I'm just having to think about.
They're recorded with the Register of Deeds, and every person that buys a lot is informed there's covenants, and they should, you know, yeah. We give them copies of them. I mean, whether it changes hand 15 times over 30 years, they're still recorded. They still control that lot.
Well, as a member of a housing association with covenants that has recently been in the court system, interpretation of covenants is largely up to the judge that's sitting on the bench at the time. Uh-huh. And that's a road that just rather not go down sometimes.
Well, one thing we can do in the meantime while the plat is catching up to this is we can get with the applicants. What we did in the case of Liberty Edition and Quail Meadow is that we took the entire list of C5 uses, and then in the case of Liberty Edition, the developer went through and said, we don't want to see this, we don't want bowling alleys, we don't want pawn shops, we don't want this, and those were just struck out of the ordinance. That basically the same thing occurred on Quail Meadows, where the developer looked at the list of C5 uses, said, we don't want any of these, and the ordinance that rezoned the property then deleted those from the list of permitted uses. That is one method, and mm-hmm. of course covenants are your relying on covenants as your other option.
Jim, you think that's okay? Or
yeah, that's fine. Yeah, I have no problem doing it that way. We just plan on doing it through the covenants.
Yeah, but and as a practical,
what we don't want to get caught up in is coming back with the site plan and going through all the approval on every one of those sites. You know, controlling what goes on there, we have no problem with, because we want probably a better development than what you're gonna would allow us. So,
well, and I appreciate the exclusivity of it, of this project, and it sounds very nice. Mm-hmm. But as a practical matter, I think it's from our standpoint as a board, it would be important to have our thoughts carry out over a longer period of time. And I think through the putting those restrictions in up front is a better way for us.
And we'll probably just mirror them in the covenants then.
Yeah.
So they'll be both places. That's fine.
Any other questions of Mr. Mays?
I can't remember if there were other issues that we haven't talked about.
No, he had addressed the straight C5 versus C5 with deleting certain undesirable uses. He explained how he was going to do the, and just to give you an example, the office building that's up there across from Jerry Ivy Park, that is C1. So when he's talking about C1 type development or uses, that's what he's talking about north of Shoreline Drive. Mm-hmm. He explained how they were going to break out between C2 and C3 along Ohio, that the orientation would be the fronts facing Ohio Street, and that the way that the townhomes were going to be done was individual lot ownership and construction as opposed to a unified development. And so he also discussed the pedestrian access, emergency access at the north end as being something that they were willing to consider. And so just, we didn't make a point of it because we're really not discussing the plat, but the city's, your policy on plats is that wherever possible physically that every subdivision should have two ways in and out, and if not, then a primary way in and out with secondary emergency access. And if you think about ones that you've seen recently, Grand Prairie Edition, 70 lots, one way in and out, River Trail, 47 lots, one way in and out, but in both those cases we have a secondary access for emergency situations. And so you've seen it both ways. You've got Highland Meadows Hamlet with one way in and out at the present time. So we will go into that in more detail with the plat, but this is primarily to, so you could have Mr. Byquist's letter on the access, and also just to give them some guidance on how you felt about their commercial request intermixed with the residential. And so As we understand it, and Jim, you may, I was in a conversation with Sam Malinowski, and he anticipated delivering plans sometime this week for the development of the subdivision portion of this, and we would take that and send it out to reviewing agencies and try to package this all together, probably second meeting in March, something along those lines, where we would have action on the zoning, action on the plat, action on the annexation. But this was to give neighboring property owners, I talked to Mr. Johnson Sand, and he didn't have, his concern was that if this was approved, would that keep him from using Schilling Road for his trucks coming out of the sand pit? And it's, everybody has to understand right now that that's a route for trucks going in and out of his sand pit. And if everybody knows that, then everybody's on the same page. And then you have the comment there from Mr. Byquist. So unless there was additional feedback that the commission wanted to give to the applicant or staff, when this comes back to you, it will be the complete package of the plat layout with lots and zoning laid on that layout. We would have reviewed the covenants and addressed how a common area is to be maintained, and have these revisions on the zoning, the C1, C2, C3, C5 breakout, hopefully with a deletion of some uses on C5.
Can we discuss the Ohio access a little bit, Dean, to the south?
Yes.
They showed that as restricted access, but what we heard today is driveways, four possibly, along Ohio?
What we anticipate is each one of the lots in Ohio would share a common driveway with the lot next to it. So whatever that count is.
Could be four
probably
to five.
Four to five of them. Correct.
One method that has been used to address that in the past and was done with the Meadow Point there on Ohio and Cloud was that at the preliminary or the actual platting stage, it gets platted as restricted access with some notations on the plat, and then when we actually have known users, sometimes you don't know whether somebody's going to use a lot and a half or two lots or with that.
Right.
You would restrict it, but then address it as driveways come up. And I do think that's a good idea of what they did at the corner there, where instead of taking the whole frontage and picking out 30 or 40 feet and saying this is the driveway, you don't know what's going to happen there. So as long as the access is restricted and the number of driveways to be built is noted on the plat, then that gives this person designing the site a little bit of leeway as to where to put those.
And it gives staff the ability to approve it at staff level rather than going through the commissions and everything.
I guess I thought the driveways were going to be on the inside drive. So you're saying there could be as many as four access points other than the main roadway off of Ohio?
Correct. On from Shoreline Drive south. Shoreline Drive north, all the accesses will be on the west side, or east side, sorry.
Why would we allow that when we don't allow that in other areas? Off of a main artery road, that we wouldn't allow that many access points.
Because certainly, again, if you look at the Applebee's Red Lobster approach, they would not have their individual driveways on 9th Street, but rather coming around like this. So one option would be to have maybe a single well-placed access, but I mean, one option is certainly to access these properties from the parallel street, such as is done on 9th Street with Red Lobster and Applebee's and places like that, or the other arrangements there like Burger King and the Spangles in there on the other side, where they don't have individual driveways on 9th Street, but you enter from the other side. That is an option that's available as well.
But when you do that, you're opening up your residential to a lot of commercial traffic, your residential street. Something that we would prefer not to do.
Yeah, we've just been very specific about limiting those access points all around. I don't know.
You know, one other option, maybe I'm wrong, but this seems to be an option, is a frontage road. If you want those businesses to have access from the Ohio side, then you put a frontage road there, which we see at Planet Avenue and some other places, and you see larger communities do that. So you really have one entrance and one exit, but you use a frontage road to gain access to the individual businesses. That's more attractive in development areas than five drives off of Ohio would be concerning, I would think.
Frontage roads, I think Dean will agree, they're kind of a thing of the past. They're doing all reverse frontage stuff now because of the safety issue where you bring them into your intersection. But this is a fairly large area we're talking here. Remember, this is not a small plat. From Shoreline down to Schilling is, what, a quarter of a mile. So we're not talking about driveways next to each other. This is a large area. The other issue, if we start into frontage roads, the lake itself, well, what we would do is lose a whole row of lots because it's not deep enough to get that number of lots across there. If you lose a row of lots, then you're going to have a row of lots with the street on both sides of it. So you're going to have lots, you know, with streets in their front yard, or a street in their front yard and their backyard.
Jim, can you estimate
just physically it just doesn't work out on this side?
I would agree with you there. Can you estimate roughly, if we just for a random thought so we can maybe get a distance in mind, if we were to take a road in the center of each two lots, kind of what the distance, I can't read from here what the lot sizes are roughly. What's our width?
If I remember right, they're 90 to 100 foot lots.
So about 200 foot per entrance.
Correct.
I mean, it does seem like a lot, but that's a little
more. We can widen that out a little bit. This was just the first blast. I mean, we can work with staff on that.
Sure.
You know, maybe we can make those lots 100, 115, something like that to reduce that. But we don't want to get tied down to too tight of a, because we need the access to be able to develop the lots. And we're not looking at, because of the size of these lots, you're not looking at high traffic generator.
Right.
But I think,
except on the very corner.
More importantly, possibly, though, if you're talking about having access off of Ohio, I don't see that traffic as ever diminishing. It's going to only increase.
Just start over again, please.
I don't think you're talking about having access off of the lots to the inside. What I think you're talking about is the traffic off of Ohio. If you put entrances off of Ohio, that traffic is only going to increase over time. I don't see that as ever getting smaller. And
correct.
And it has been our history to limit access on arterial streets. And certainly, Ohio would have to be considered a major arterial street.
Mm-hmm. And we are. We're limiting it. You know, we're not asking for access to each one. I mean, we're going to have four accesses, say, along that stretch of road.
I'm sure, I mean, that's, when it comes,
what we're
back
asking
to us,
for.
Staff will show us the history in other places and what's been allowed and what hasn't.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah,
again, we're not that level on the plat today. We're mostly talking about the conceptual land uses, and we will staff that through for you and give you actual distances and separations and,
well, I guess,
all
note
of that for
note
you.
From our standpoint,
right,
that it's a concern anyway.
Right.
Yes, we'll address it with staff in the final development.
Thank you.
Well, I think the concept is definitely good. I mean, I think we all agree that, you know, this is that Salina could definitely use a development like this. I have no problem with the commercial on there. I'm a little concerned about too many entrances, but if we're estimating about 200 foot, that's a pretty good distance. I mean, that's a pretty good distance there. And there may be something where maybe one end for the first two, and maybe four of the inner lots can have a maybe slightly wider one, or, you know, there's some other ways we can address that when that bridge comes to us. So,
and on the multifamily, there would be no access points to the north there?
Off of Ohio, no. They'll all be off of the residential street.
Okay.
And that will be restricted access.
Yeah, and that's the dilemma and our distinction here between, say, Marketplace and Planet Avenue and some of those streets is that if this were Applebee's and this were Marketplace here, the difference is this is Sam's Club and Target over mm-hmm. here, and in this case it's housing.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got to balance the not pushing all that's one of the dilemmas of mixed use development is you have uneven traffic
mm-hmm.
patterns and you've got to blend in the commercial and the residential traffic patterns, so that is something that we'll have to work through in detail on the plat. But I guess like the comments that Mr. Householder just had, that for feedback for staff and the applicant, that the whole concept of mixed use with commercial and multifamily on the frontage is you're supportive of that, and the devil will be in the details.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So again, for items 2 and 3, no formal action is required other than giving them a forum and some feedback. And when the plat is ready and has been staffed through, we will bring those three items for you to consider all together.
So it wasn't a public hearing of any kind?
This was a public hearing. You could see if anybody has comments. There's not very many adjoining owners, and I think I've talked individually to all of them, but you can go ahead and see if
we had a letter from Mr. Bryquist. Is there anybody else that would like to address a commission on this item or either of these two items regarding this? Okay, thank you. None being heard, we'll move on to item number 4, application Z10-2, filed by Dennis Collier, requesting a change in zoning district classification from R1 single-family residential to R3 multifamily residential to allow construction of a new five-plex apartment building on property legally described as the south half of Lot 6, Block 17 of the South Park Addition to the City of Salina, Saline County, Kansas, and addressed as 662 to 664 South 9th Street. Dean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We are in a neighborhood here where the platting dates back to the 1890s and housing to the early 1900s, and that's an area, the South Park Addition is the area west of 9th Street and north of Crawford Street. And there was formerly a South Park school in that area. And the way the city's grown south, it's not a South Park anymore, but it was at the time. And we don't have an exact date on the specific dwelling on this property, but our records indicate that this is a property that dates back to the early 1900s. And the location is about 4 lots north of Crawford Street on the west side of South 9th. And what appears happened was that during the time when the Air Force Base was active, that the house was converted so that there were additional living units. But in 1977, when the city was comprehensively rezoned and remapped, the property was designated R1 single family because that is consistent with the zoning of surrounding property. So that had the effect of making this a pre-existing non-conforming structure. And the current owner, Mr. Collier, acquired this property and has been using it as a rental property. He recently approached city staff with the concept of removing this property from the site and building back in its place a five-plex apartment building. And you have a concept plan for that. And this is a relatively narrow lot at 50 feet, but it's also unusually deep at 200 feet, and that is unusual, especially for a single family lot. And the plan that's conceptually being proposed is proposing a two-story building. It would run long ways on the site. And this orientation would be that this is 9th Street, this is the south side, north, and the alley back here. There would be a sidewalk here, and the entrances would face to the south coming off that sidewalk. So they're looking at 5 units, a two-story building, with proposed setbacks of 12 feet on the south and 8 feet on the north. What this boils down to is that we have R1 zoning and we have a request to build a new apartment building, and that's not permitted in R1, so the request is to rezone the property to R3. And we've kind of have gone through and summarized there for you some of the requirements. I think the main thing that's notable, and it's not, we're still at the conceptual stage, but based on the substandard right-of-way for 9th Street and the right-of-way width, the zoning setback for any new structures on 9th Street would be 75 feet from center line, which would be 45 feet from property line. This depiction is at 30 feet, which matches most of the development pattern there, but could result in requiring some sort of front yard setback variance if we got to that point. But as far as rear yard, side yard, buffers, those fit and are acceptable. Because this would have 10 parking spaces to serve 5 units, those spaces would have to be paved. And so if we look at the suitability of this site for development or redevelopment, if somebody was going to tear this down, certainly the applicant believes that the R1 zoning inhibits the redevelopment of this property, given that there's currently at least 3 rental units there, and removal of that and going back to single family would take away some of that ability to rent units there. And so again, it's certainly possible to tear down and build back a single family home, but when you look at the 200 foot depth, you look at the location on an arterial street that's fairly busy, being close to Crawford and being next door to C5 zoning and businesses, it's easy to make an argument that if you couldn't build multifamily here, it'd be hard pressed to find another location where it fit. And so if you look at the surrounding neighborhood, it still is predominantly single family, except directly south of this you've got a plumbing contractor's office, a chiropractor's office, a blade sharpening business, and a convenience store across the way. And so, you know, certainly one thing for you to look at is, do you view this as a good buffer use between what's on the corner and the single family farther to the north, or do you view this as creating potential negative impacts for neighboring owners and residents? Certainly everything is in place as from a water, sewer, storm sewer, gas, and electrical lines. One thing the applicant may need to look at is if we're stepping up to a 5-unit building, they may need to upgrade the existing water services to support 5 living units, but the network is certainly there. 9th Street in this location carries over 13,000 vehicles a day. We've got a platted alley at the rear. The proposal is to have parking both front and back. We've had some discussions about, there is some precedent for having a surfacing of the alley when you have a use introduced that creates additional traffic on the alley from what you had before. So certainly I think if we add 7 or 8 parking spaces at the rear, that is going to intensify the use of the alley. Some of the neighbors had told me that there was a previous effort to try to get that alley paved between Charles and Crawford, but that they couldn't get 50% of the abutting owners to go along with that. But that is a discussion point. And again, this is a transition area. It's shown as low density residential on the current plan because that matches up with the R1 zoning, but a lot of this just depends on, if you look at some of the policies in there for multifamily, multifamily housing should be on the edge of residential neighborhoods and near other major traffic generators. New medium and high density housing should be along major streets. So that's really a matter of your view of whether this is a good buffer use between existing commercial and residential to the north. So the options that we have identified for you is you could recommend approval of the applicant's request to change the zoning of the property to R3 and convert it to apartment use. In other words, recommend approval as submitted. You could direct the applicant to amend the application to a planned development district, which would require submittal and approval of a binding site plan. That has a plus and minus to it. It actually has several pluses, but one plus of the planned development district is that there would be some assurance that what is submitted in the way of a plan gets built. The other thing that a planned development district could address is the proposed 30-foot setback from 9th Street. If this were a planned development district, then that setback could be adjusted through the PDD process as opposed to a variance. But it's really a function. We just want to make clear that this is a concept plan. It's not binding on the applicant. It could be if it was done as a planned development district. So if you believe a change should only be approved in reference to a specific plan for the site, the PDD option is a means to achieve that. And I guess if your thoughts were that this request should be denied, then is there any other adaptive reuse of this property that you would be willing to support? We wouldn't want the applicant to go back and spend additional time on detailed plans or drawings or other things like that if there was not support for the request or the concept. So I guess the two options would be to recommend the approval of R3 if you're supportive, and whatever gets built there will have to comply with R3 requirements, or if you think this is a good plan and want to make sure this is the way it is done and have a binding site plan, then a planned development district is one option to achieve that. And of course, postponing if you need additional information or recommending denial is certainly an option as well. At the back of your packet there was, I've had conversations with a few neighbors. Most of them were inquisitive and didn't really have a position, but there is a letter in your packet from a nearby property owner that I'd want to refer to you. So with that, I would take any questions that you have, and then you could hear from the applicant and any members of the public that are interested.
Questions of staff?
Yeah, I have a question about the setback on the front main in relationship to the parking.
Parking, I don't, 30 foot is not long enough the way the parking's laid out to park and not have to back out on the ninth. Am I correct?
Well, I think what we would try to work with them on is out in this area, perhaps. We actually did this on Front Street across from Central High with some success. There was an apartment building that was moved in onto a vacant lot on the west side of Front Street there, had a similar arrangement, and you would try to come up with some wings over, if this was two parking stalls, a wing out over here and a wing out over here, so you could back into that wing, and rather than having a driveway throat that wide, you would narrow this down and then have wings there so people could back there and then head out. So again, this is conceptual, but I think something could be done to put wings here and narrow this down, and so you'd back into that wing and head out, because we wouldn't want to encourage direct backing into 9th Street. I would agree. The 30-foot setback, when you're figuring the sidewalk here and then the length of the stalls, it does reduce down the area that you have for backing and maneuvering. So moving that to 35 feet or sliding it additional 5 feet may work better to get more maneuvering room there.
Is there no green space then?
Well, this would be green space here and here, and then if we narrow this throat down here, you would pick up a little more right out at the driveway.
And on that, where the alley then is to the far...
It's right here.
Right, okay. And so access off the alley, there would be no access along the sides of the building, right, for parking?
Correct. It's okay. Too narrow.
Just from the alley and from 9th Street.
Right. And so this is a sidewalk here, here, and here. And so if you were parking back here, you would take this sidewalk to get to the front door of your unit, which would face south.
And we don't know what the front face of that building would look like. I mean, I see pictures of a doorway, which would be on
right,
the south
side. Right, that's a south elevation.
Right.
Again, if this were a planned development district, or if you wanted to approve it with reference to that, then we would obtain an elevation that would show what that would look like from 9th Street, whether it would have windows or no windows, or whether it would have this trim or just be flatboard siding. That is a possibility.
I take it your concern is about it fitting in with the other homes?
Yeah. Generally, my thought is almost anything's going to look better than what's there now and would improve the property surrounding it. But
right, you're correct that most of the properties are have their fronts towards 9th Street, and this would be turned on its side.
Right. Mm-hmm. So I think to be sensitive to those other property owners, we need to have some idea of, yeah.
How much further to the back will the building go than it is now?
Well, I guess do you have the aerial photo, John?
What I'm really asking is how much space have you got left for whatever behind the building?
By my count, there would be 70 feet from the back of the building to the alley. Mm-hmm. For that.
That's a way of asking, can you, since 70? This is conceptual, can you slide the building back the additional 15 feet that we need?
If you reduce the parking area in back to 55 feet, you'll be a little tighter back there, but there's probably some room on the front to slide it back. But I think if you got to the full 45 feet off the front and then you only had 55 feet in back, that would be a little tighter to get all those spaces back there, because as a general rule, you would need 62 feet in here to make that work, and this has 20, 24, and 20, and then with a sidewalk here.
Yeah, so what about sliding it forward and have all the parking in the back?
That is a possibility, but that would best be addressed again through the
PDD.
The PDD, where you could reduce the required setback. But if you slid it all forward, then you would pick up some additional area there to have all the parking in back.
How far is the building set back right now?
I couldn't tell you, but it's not 30 feet.
Pretty tight.
It's pretty snug up there to 9th Street. I'm not sure that the parking stalls that are there don't overhang on the right-of-way somewhat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's actually going to set back a little further.
Yes.
I would guess
it's maybe like 15 feet to the front of that porch.
Yeah.
If that. 12, 15 feet.
And the other buildings are on the same line?
Well, some of the houses as you go north are set farther back, but the buildings that are to the south, I think we're talking right here, so it does sit a little bit forward of things, but this house is set back farther, and then this is our house here, and this is the plumbing shop, so we're talking right here. There's an addition on the back, but it's covered up by trees. But this is pretty close to 9th Street compared to some of the other buildings.
So, yeah, less invasive already, more attractive.
Any concerns on the additional traffic coming out of that alley onto Crawford, potentially turning left?
Well, I think anytime you introduce that traffic onto the alley here, then the condition of the alley and introducing that extra traffic becomes an issue. And then it's not a vision clearance obstruction, but you will have to get all the way out to here to get a sight line there. And of course, you do have the option of going up. Mm-hmm. If you pan down, John, you can get up to Charles.
So is that alley that you do allow vehicular traffic in that alley currently?
Yes, a lot of these homes along here on 10th Street have access back there. I mean, this has a driveway, this has a driveway, this is a driveway here and an outbuilding. So it's just when you add, you know, 8 parking stalls, or even there was a discussion of 10, and everybody's coming in and out this way, it is going to pick up traffic on that alley that's not there today. There's no doubt about it.
And would you talk a little bit more about paving that alley? The thought is that...
Well, if it has primarily been a case where somebody is incorporating the alley into their parking lot or circulation. If you look at the center there at the corner of Oakdale and Iron, where Dr. Stewie is, and he incorporated the alley as part of his parking lot circulation, that alley was paved just as the parking lot was paved. For two reasons. It was incorporated into the lot, and secondly, because that was introducing additional traffic into that alley. We've had a case where Bogey's drive-through emptied into an alley, and the alley was paved as a result because it increased the traffic on it. Here, you're not immediately adjacent to Crawford. If this was right here, I think it would be a little clearer case that you would simply, this has to be paved, so this kind of becomes an extension of that. But the other means to do that would be if more than 50% of the owners that abutted that alley petitioned or would sign a petition to create a benefit district for it, then it could be paved that way. And that was tried in the past, and they couldn't quite muster 50% of the abutting owners. But those would be the options. It would be a bit of a stretch to say that somehow this owner would be solely responsible for that alley, but I think everybody needs to recognize that this plan would increase the volume of traffic using that alley compared to today.
And all the property owners would share the cost of paving an alley?
Right. If you did that, you would have everybody who backed up to it would pay their proportionate share for that stretch of alley divided by 2.
Any further questions of staff? Would the applicant care to address the commission? Your name and address, please.
Daryl Dunn, 1273 Aspen Road. I'm here to address you for Denny Collier. You have to excuse me, I'm getting over a terrible cold, so my voice is something. Anyway, as you can see by the proposal, it would be an upgrade to the area. Understand your concerns, probably architecturally blending in. One of the things that we haven't done was we haven't spent a lot of money on plans just yet, just so we can see if we can do this. you know, my concept and the owner's concept is this would be a nice looking addition on 9th Street. The elevation facing 9th Street, we would do something special with it. It wouldn't just be the end of a building facing 9th Street, basically because that would be the part of the building that would be seen the most, you know, by people on 9th Street. I did see the letter addressing the concerns. One was a property tax concern. I think everybody in here probably shares a concern about their property tax, but I don't think this would be looked at as a comparable to be used to increase the property tax of anyone owning property around it. Also, I think we can honestly take a look at the property that stands there now. And Mrs. Tustin addresses that the residents of that property have been a problem in the past. I think we would be bringing in a different clientele in this building. So by doing that, we would alleviate, by building this, we would alleviate one of those issues.
Mr. Dunn, what are you, just a rough idea of what the places will rent for?
I'm sorry, could you say?
A rough idea of what the places will rent for, the duplexes?
I don't know. We haven't done a cost analysis on the building of the project yet either. And so.
Appreciably more than what.
Appreciably more than what rent is bringing currently.
How many people are living there now?
There are three units there now.
There are
and
three.
I'm not privy to the what my customer has as far as living
windows
there.
Windows that are broken and. You wouldn't have any, would you have any problems if this were approved on the condition that it's a planned development district?
I wouldn't.
Okay. That would limit what you build in what you bring to us. In other words, the plan that you bring to us would be largely what would need to be built in the.
I understand that. And of course, that's something I would have to discuss with my client, you know. But I think that's fine.
Any further questions of the applicant? Thank you.
Thank you.
Would anyone else in the audience care to address this application? Your name and address, please.
I'm Mike Bachover. I run the plumbing shop adjacent south of the property Denny owns. I guess my biggest concern is that probably the alley. That alley sees a lot of traffic now. And on the east side, south end of the alley, there's a triplex. And that end of the alley gets tore up pretty good when people back out and turn their tires. The whole south end's all potholes back. The next property, both sides of the alley, south end, use the alley for their drives. Same way at the north end of the alley. And then the next property is a paved parking lot that's a chiropractor south of my property. And that area is paved, but the alley is actually higher in elevation than his parking lot. So any runoff of water right now floods pretty much his whole parking lot's underwater for weeks at a time if we get a pretty good rain. I think right now a lot of the runoff gets soaked into the ground on the property that where he Denny wants to build the fiveplex. I would be concerned with probably the additional traffic in the alley. Like I say, it's pretty rough now in the alley when you drive down it. But then the other thing would be runoff for you know, stormwater. I'm sure that's probably something that is addressed, but I don't know with a parking lot back there where the water's going to go that's currently probably soaking in the ground in that area. And I don't know if paving the alley would remedy that if they made the alley, you know, kind of a low center where it would drain. And at the south end at Crawford right now, the approach is pretty steep uphill into the alley, so I don't know if it could be regraded and nobody's ever put a transit on it to see what the elevations are and if we have enough grade to run the water that direction. The other thing, I guess, too, is the traffic issue that was mentioned for cars coming and going at the south end of the alley. There's already times when people are trying to come out of the alley, people stop eastbound on Crawford and are trying to turn left into the alley, and then if anybody's headed west and tries to turn southbound on 10th Street, then it all gets bottlenecked up, and there's already a lot of that going on. And I don't know if you'd run into the same problem with traffic headed south on 9th and a car headed north getting into the turn lane to turn into the apartment, if people southbound on 9th wanting to go east to get into the turn lane are going to be faced off at each other. I guess I don't know either. Since mine's zone C5, is there any stipulations as far as my place is going to look pretty bad compared to what they're building. I don't know if there's a fence requirement or something, so the people that rent that don't have to look at old water heaters and stuff that's on my property. If that's something that's as far as a privacy fence or anything like that that's required.
Yeah, that was all done a long time ago, but that would be a present requirement, would be for them to create a screening fence between that sidewalk and the south property line, not abutting the building, but abutting any rear yard storage there. You're saying you've got some storage along here?
Yes, I do, and in the back too, I guess. There would be.
It would primarily be screening along here, but if there is storage here.
Yeah, that's just a driveway with trailers and vehicles parked there too. So, not that it would, I guess, bother me so much as the people that are, paying rent to rent Denny's place, looking at my stuff. I wouldn't want to have to pay, through the nose to put up a privacy fence down the road to block an eyesore, as far as they're concerned, looking at my property. So. I don't know how many properties out of all the alley, but there's probably 10 properties use that alley already to come and go from their houses. So I don't know if adding more parking, I know that alley takes a beat now. I don't know if the city's ever put a rubber hose traffic counter in there, but I bet they'd be surprised how much traffic was up and down that alley.
Dean, I guess that's a question right now. How does the city handle maintenance issues on alleys right now? Do you know that information?
Primarily on there's an annualized basis. They get a lot of reports back from primarily the alleys are used for trash collection and city trash trucks, so they will get maintenance reports back from them, whether it's branches over the alley or obstructions or potholes for things about drainage or crowns. One of the things that happens is if you do have traffic and there's additional material brought into the alley, then it's going to tend to make the alley higher in elevation because you keep adding material to it. One of the advantages of the alley being paved is that you can a lot of times put a V or trough in it kind of in the center and have everything drained to the center of the alley and get it to go one direction or the other. But if there's complaints about needing additional material on the alley, it's only going to build it up more so that the alley is higher than the adjoining property, which then means it's either going to trap water or shed water. But for things like drainage or potholes or things like that, it's primarily on a citizen report or complaint basis.
Is your question regarding drainage?
Well, yeah, drainage and probably the alley is so bad right now. One of the guys there in about the middle of the block was out Sunday with a scoop shovel filling in holes because he's got a work trailer and he drives down the alley and it shakes so bad it throws everything in his trailer off onto the floor and tear stuff up in there. So he was trying to fill it in there, but even if they grade it, when they grade it, within about a week to 2 weeks, the alley's right back to what it was. And I didn't realize really until I talked to the man at the north end of the alley. He had been to school for asphalt parking lots and all that. He explained to me what happens is people back out and they turn their tires. That immediately starts a pothole. And the south end of the alley is really bad because there's a triplex, and then the opposite side of the alley is another house. And they back out and park parallel with the alley, so they're constantly backing out, turning, and then there's parking in front of the triplex too. They back out and turn. So there's a lot of wear, especially like I say at the south end. And I like to say even after they grade it, it's right back to what it was within a couple weeks, probably max. It's pretty rough again. So I don't know if added traffic, if we're gonna compound that, and unless the grader came once a week, and I don't know what the schedule is normally for, you know, but I know it's usually not, you know, it's several months in between, and it gets pretty bad. So that was my main two.
Thank you for your concerns.
Thank you.
Anyone else care to address the commission on this item? Any further questions of staff? Dean, I have one. As part of any review process, whether that be if we change the zoning district or if we do a PDD, part of the one element of that is a drainage a review of the drainage of that lot. Is that correct?
If they submit development plans for rebuilding the site and constructing the parking at the rear, we're going to want to see where that drains. But I would imagine that if what Mr. Bachover says is true and there's a built-up area to the south of this, then to a degree that's a city maintenance problem if that is keeping water from getting down the alley into Crawford, because I think that's where the water at the rear is eventually intended to get out of the alley and go down here. You wouldn't want a series of ponds back here, but there's no doubt that taking this, lengthening it, adding paved surface back here, you're going to increase the runoff. But for a building permit, it's generally not a requirement to have a full-blown drainage study or analysis, but to at least have a grading plan or civil plan that shows the elevations and direction of flow. And we'd also be looking at the downspouts on the building itself to see which way they're directed. Because we would probably want it directed west and east, not directly south onto Mr. Bachover or directly north onto that neighbor. We want to get it out to 9th Street and to the alley.
Any further questions of staff?
You had mentioned the screening and the fence. You know, my point of view is I don't know where Mr. Bachover should be fiscally liable for that, because I mean, I don't know how that's going to be set up, but
yeah, I think in this case, if Mr. Bachover was coming along with his business, it is a normal course of that the business screens from the residents, but that's if they're introducing a new business. In this case, it's the change in use to the apartment and that facing there, that I believe that any kind of screening fence along the south property line would be the responsibility of the apartment builder and not Mr. Bachover.
If this is approved as a PDD, then how much would staff be looking at? You know, for instance, I'm thinking if the alleyway is a major problem and you shift the building all the way back to the alleyway and then somehow figure out parking and landscaping just in the front, but how much would you be able to be involved in that kind of planning of in a PDD?
Well, if this were a planned development district, then we would have basically latitude to place the building anywhere on the site that was appropriate, either sliding it back to get parking in front or sliding it forward to get all 10 spaces in back. Then I guess it's incumbent on the city and the folks that are in charge of maintaining the alley to go out there and do an inspection of that and perhaps provide a report on their recommendations for improving it or making it suitable. I would think, just from the descriptions, that we probably have existing problems in that alley today that we'd still need to address even if this wasn't being proposed. And then if you want to require that an elevation drawing for what it would look like facing 9th Street be submitted, that could be part of it. And if you wanted to require the depiction of the location of a screening fence along the south property line, that could be part of that action as well. But what the plan development district would do, it would allow you the flexibility to approve whatever setbacks were appropriate, but it also, you could incorporate elevation drawings and screening and things like that into your action, whereas otherwise that would be just left to the building permit review.
Then I will move approval of application Z10-2 to be amended, the application to be amended as a planned development district with consideration for placement of the building on the site in regards to parking and alleyway drainage and condition. And it seemed like there was something else you mentioned.
You were talking about an elevation.
Oh, and the fence.
Okay.
Fencing.
And you would want to see an elevation drawing,
yes,
of the 9th,
yeah,
Street frontage.
Right.
I second that motion.
It's been moved and seconded to approve application. Sorry, I don't have the number handy.
Well, I think it would be incorrect to use the word approve. I think the correct term would be to direct the applicant to amend this to a planned development district, and then we would work with them to develop some of those things to bring back to you.
That's so. Exactly what I meant.
That's exactly what I said.
Take the words out.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? None being heard. Motion carries. All right. Get my computer back up here. For those of you who don't know, we are saving the city money by, there's a few of us who are getting our packets in the mail, I mean online. And some of us are bringing our laptops to save paper and save the postage costs of associated with that and the printing costs for the city. And so far it's working out good. We're learning. So if I'm a little slow on the mouse pad here, that's why.
Well, it's nice when you by mail get this thing 2 hours before you're supposed to be here.
Uh-oh.
That was nice.
Yeah.
That's the post office fault, not mine.
Yeah. That's president. Yeah, and it is nice to be able to read them over the weekend online. Okay, application, or I'm sorry, agenda item number 5, application Z92-6A, filed by Jeff Rosner on behalf of Casey's General Stores, requesting an amendment of PC5, Planned Service Commercial District, to allow new drying equipment and overhead doors to be added to their automatic car wash facility. Subject property is located at the southwest corner of 9th Street and Crawford Street and is addressed at 215 West Crawford in Salina. We have, I guess, a sister amendment to this one on Ohio and Iron. I guess conceptually we could get to both of these in one.
Yeah, they're just slightly different background, but as far as the nature of the request, Mr. Hers could probably if he describes what they're proposing to do in a way of modifications, it would fit for both sites.
I think the nature of the request is fairly simple. The Casey's General Store Company has recently acquired the old Green Lanterns at those two locations, those two corners there at Iron and Ohio, and this one here at Crawford and 9th Street. And what they're wanting to do is put new equipment in the automatic washing bays of those respective locations. And with that new equipment, they have a hot air drying system to help dry off the cars as part of their automatic car wash package. And with that, they're proposing to put in some overhead doors. So we're not looking at any additions or new buildings or modifications to the exteriors of any of the buildings. We're just looking at those modifications to the car wash. So the nature or the request is rather simple, but what is kind of complicated is some of the background history, because both of these properties are adjacent to residential neighborhoods. And when they originally approved as planned commercial districts, there was some input from the neighbors that we want to kind of go into here. So the location of the Crawford and 9th Street store is just down the street from our last application that we looked at for the apartment building. And it was originally filed as a rezoning change in May of 1992 by Bob Ott and Green Lantern. And what they wanted to do is rezone a couple of residential lots to C5 zoning so that they could allow the construction of a new convenience store with gas pumps and a self-service car wash facility with 5 service bays. In June of 1992, about a month later, the Planning Commission had their public hearing, and there was plenty of public input, most of it with opposition from the adjacent property owners. And so the Planning Commission suggested that the applicant go back to the drawing board, so to speak, and amend their site plan and restrict their access off of the alley there so that they wouldn't have any access. Then they came back 2 weeks later in June on 16th, 1992, and the Planning Commission approved 6-1 the PC5 zoning request that the applicant had at that time, with a few conditions. The 4 conditions were that they utilize special insulated vacuums to soften the sound of the vacuums and not disrupt the residential neighborhoods that were adjacent, that they utilize directional lighting, downcast lighting, so that there wasn't a lot of light spill that would interfere and cause, some issues at nighttime for the adjacent property owners in the residential areas, and that they muffle the sound of the beeping signal at the car wash. That's the hand car wash that when you're down to a minute or something, it'll start alerting you that you need to put more quarters in if you're not quite finished. That they soften that sound so that it wasn't beeping all day long, irritating the neighbors. And that a solid fence would be constructed, extending from the sidewalk that would prevent access from the site to the alley on the east. So we have a surrounding solid wood fence that was there for screening purposes as well. On June 29th, 1992, the 16 adjacent property owners submitted a full petition with 51.5% of land areas protesting the Planning Commission's approval. This petition made it necessary for the City Commission to have a supermajority in their voting of the approval of this particular planned commercial district. That supermajority is a 4-5 vote, 4 people in favor of, in order to approve it. And on July 6th, that is what the City Commission did. They voted 4-1 to approve the planned commercial district with those same 4 conditions that the Planning Commission approved. Given the sensitivity of the noise at this facility, staff decided to place this plan on your agenda because of the sensitivity, like I said, with the previous history behind it. In your packets, there's a couple of tables that I've provided there One was is the decibel sound of these hot air drying units with the door open, and another is with the door closed. And those measurements are typical measurements that would be taken from the entrance side and the exit side. In this particular case, the entrance side is along the 9th Street, so in other words, west of the car wash, while the exit side is to the east of the car wash. And you can see those numbers and what they look like with their respective distances. With the doors closed at 40 feet, we're relatively at a talking decibel, about 64 and a half decibels. So with the door shut, it should be muffled quite a bit, the sound of the dryers there. The site that we're looking at is a little over an acre with 12% lot coverage. And as I said, none of the setbacks or any of the buildings are going to be changing. All of the stacking that is there for the car wash bays will remain the same, with three on the ninth Street side, with the car wash bay serving as the fourth stacking space. There's no changes to the access. All of the curb cuts will remain the same. There's one 30-foot curb cut along 9th Street, and one 40-foot and a 20-foot curb cut on Crawford. Those will remain. There aren't any new proposed parking changes, any addition or subtraction of any of the parking stalls that are currently on the site, and the proposed amendment wouldn't require any. There's no lighting that is proposed, and the current lighting that is there now is the shoebox downcast style that's required in the existing planned commercial development. The one of the changes that has taken place, I'm sure you've noticed, is to the signage. Since Casey's has acquired the store, they've swapped out the old Green Lantern signage for their Casey's logo signage that they have. That resulted in six signs on this site. One is the pole sign, which is 68 square feet. The other is two 20 square foot signs on the convenience store, with an additional matching 20 square foot sign on the car wash, and then above the canopy above the gas pumps on the canopy, there are two 15 square feet Casey's logo signs there as well. As with all applications, the Planning Commission has the right or the choice of approving or disapproving the plan as Casey's has submitted. They could approve the plan subject to certain revisions or conditions, or they could recommend that the plan be resubmitted to the Planning Commission after substantial revisions to the plan. Staff believes that the proposed changes to the plan comply with the C5 regulations and the existing conditions that were put on the planned commercial development. I think what we would do is carry over many of those same conditions that were originally part of this planned development, and we would add that the doors of the automated car wash bay remain closed at all times when the car wash is in operation for both the cleaning cycle and the drying cycle, and that a building permit for this car wash dryer installation be obtained within 18 months of approval.
Do we want to do both at the same time, or do
both? Well, we may have public comment for one and not the other. So,
any questions of Mr. Hurst?
Got a couple.
Currently, right now, is there any decibel studies on what the noise is coming out of that, without doors and the noise that just the brushes or the car wash makes now?
Sure. I'm not aware of any. I don't know if the applicant would be aware of any. I would imagine it'd be higher than what it would be if the doors are closed, but that's correct. Something that the applicant can maybe and speak to a little more.
Right along those lines, I went over there, and when I saw your decibel chart, I thought, I'm going to go over there and take a listen. Any idea what the traffic noise is around there in terms of decibels? Because that's what I got. It seemed like it was quite a bit higher than any.
Is the traffic about a 75?
On a busy arterial street, the general rule of thumb is it's around 70 decibels.
And there's 13,000 cars that go by there a day.
Right.
Yeah. That's a bit. Yeah, both these sites are busy intersections, right. Both roads and at each.
I'm sorry, Commissioner Meyer, okay. I did not mean to interrupt you. I just.
The closest residential to that side, do you know the distance? It appears to me it's over, it's at least 40, if not more.
I think this distance here is maybe a little over 20 feet, if I remember correctly. And John can get us a good guesstimation here for us.
Looks like about 30 feet.
Okay.
And then you have the alley separation on the east from the properties to the east.
One final question.
Sure.
On the east side, those are the vacuums. Even insulated, do you know the decibels of those? What good are you?
I don't know. I don't have a decibel meter, you know? I don't know.
I would think those would be as loud as the dryers. I mean, even insulated. I mean, I don't know how many of us have used them, but I've used them, and they seem loud.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, I'm done.
I just wanted to point out one thing there. The tool that John was using, first of all, the interactive mapping, anybody can get on a computer on the website and on the city's website and go to interactive mapping, and you can access the same aerial views that are here, and you can also use that measuring tool that he was using. That's a handy little thing, and you can kind of get a rough estimate. It's certainly nothing you should take to a surveyor, but if you want to know a distance from something, that information is easily accessible on ci.ks.salina.gov. Thank you. Go ahead.
I'm not sure. I don't know that this type of dryer, but can it be used when the door's closed?
That is their intent, so I hope so.
The bay's long enough to do that, and the dryer must move over the car then.
The dryer, from our understanding, from the applicant, it will be constructed completely inside the existing bay, with the car, with the overhead doors being at the current entrance and current exit at the openings.
Actually, what you're saying here is that the only change from now would be the addition of a dryer, and the doors would be closed when you use that dryer.
That's what we're proposing as a requirement, as a condition of approval. But yes, that's essentially all of the changes that the applicant is requesting are internal to that automatic car wash bay.
Okay. It would seem to me like with the doors closed, there wouldn't be much change. And also, we have no idea what it would be because we have no information on it.
Yeah, I think, Dean, I just quickly discussed that when this goes to the City Commission, if you were to approve it, we'll have to see if we can get some information as far as some of those decibel levels that have been discussed. Now, we don't have a decibel meter to get exact information, but we can at least get you some averages on what traffic is, on what some of those vacuums maybe are, some of that information we can find, that it's generic information.
Well, grossly, do you know whether it'd be more noise than now or less noise because the doors are closed?
Well, I know as a point of reference, looking at the decibel chart that the applicant has provided from the dealer of the manufacturer of these air dryers, that with the door shut, we're looking at about 64 decibels, which is right around a regular conversation sound. So I'm guessing, you know, just qualitatively, nothing quantitative or measured here, that it may be actually quieter.
I guess I would add two things. One is that when we looked at this, because of the numerous public hearings and the sensitivity about noise in the first place, for perception reasons, we wanted the neighborhood to be notified so they'd have an opportunity to comment on this rather than just having it installed. That's important. And then when I saw the proposal, my first response is that Casey's General Stores is an Iowa company, and this is an Iowa thing, that you would never have an open air car wash and give car washes to people in the winter in Iowa without enclosed drawers and a dryer. Because if you're in the wintertime in Iowa and you wash your car and you drive out everything will freeze immediately. So the concept is you go through the dryer and you're bone dry when you exit, and then you don't have everything freeze. So they're taking what is a standard practice in more northern states and applying that here.
Very good. Any further questions of staff or Mr. Hurst? Would the applicant care to address the commission? Your name and address, please.
Jeff Rosner, Jamaica, Iowa. That's correct. Basically, we've got 28 other car washes. Car washes are fairly new for Casey's, but we want to heat these units. Currently, you have the water running constantly to keep them from freezing up. It's a flush system. What we want to do is put all of our other car washes, we have doors on them, so that is a standard practice for us. We put heaters inside there. That way we can go ahead and we just avoid the freezing process. It does a better job for our customers that way as well. So that's the majority. This is a very noisy unit. The one unit is I believe it's a 1993 unit that's in there now. Rayco, so it's earlier technology. The other one I believe is a 1997 unit. So the newer units are considerably quieter, even on the compressed water coming out. So that alone I think would be quite a difference. The dryers are mounted on the treadle, so what we'll do is remove all the metal on the floor so it opens up the unit. That way you don't have to drive through, you don't have to hit the exact spot as you drive on there. It'll be an open, and then it's got electronic finders that find the car actually. So we do put a little bit of some lines on the pavement just to prevent customers from getting too far over to one side. But as the unit goes over it, all it has is one arm hanging down, and then it washes. It'll actually map the car, it washes it, and then the dryer units mount on that unit as well. So when it goes back and forth, the car will stay in one spot, and it'll go, and the dryers blast straight down. So you do not, there are a few of the units where they actually mount the dryers on the outside, and they are considerably noisier. These units are inside, and especially with the doors down, I think it'll actually be quieter than it is now.
And then it sounds like these will save water also in the process.
Correct, considerable amount of water through the winter months especially, because right now you have to have the water running constantly to keep them from freezing. Well, that's where we want to go and put a dryer or a gas heater unit inside. We normally maintain ours at between 40 to 45 degrees temperature in the unit. So every time you pull in, that way all the car or all the slush and so forth that falls off, then it goes ahead as the doors close back down. When the cars are gone, it'll melt that out, and it just avoids all that hassle anyway. So it's kind of an improvement of the area. It helps improves the quality for everybody.
I'm sure in no way you're criticizing Green Lantern, right?
Not at all.
Yeah.
Now, Jeff, you supervise the installation of these in a lot of places. Anybody complain about noise?
No, we have never had any noise complaints on it. The one thing that we're doing a little bit different here, normally we have the doors open during the summertime, actually. We normally do not have the doors closed just because that helps alleviate the water problem. You don't, because algae and so forth is an issue in car wash industry. So that's why what we would do in this situation, if we're required to have the doors close on us during the summer, and what we were actually proposing rather than closing both doors is the back door, because that was more where we were thinking the issue. That way we could have the a lot of the water coming out and so forth. But it's not a big issue to close both doors while we're actually doing the car wash unit itself. Then we can have the doors go up while it's sitting empty when it's above that 40 or 45 degree temperature. That way it goes ahead and we lose it. So it's really not a big issue either way on that. So.
You got any specs on the vacuum?
No, I do not. I should have brought some of that. I guess I didn't even think about the vacuum on it. But I would guess that it's higher than that 86 that we've got there for, but I really don't know that. Just the sound of the unit itself, I know the dryers are considerably louder than the unit itself, and that unit is considerably noisier than most of our other units, just when it's running, just the, like I say, that older technology, just the air compressors and so forth, apparently. I'm not sure exactly how it is, so, but that's just a little different technology.
I guess we would have a question just from the operational standpoint. Are the dryers used year-round or just in the winter months?
Year-round. Actually, we have normally a four position, or you would have a four price slot for drying the car. So if you wanted to go, number one would be the basic wash, and that would not include the dryer. Slot number two generally has a wax and a sealant on it there. Number three is your deluxe. So, and then number four, usually number three and four can be set up with the dryer, and that's the normal operation. So generally half to two thirds of your washes, you're not going to have the dryer on anyway.
Okay. Any further questions of the applicant?
I guess we would refer you to item D on page 6 of your supplemental report, and I guess the intent there was primarily to focus on the rear door where vehicles are exiting, because that's the door that abuts the residential areas. So if that was clarified or supplemented to say the rear doors shall remain closed, then I think that would be workable. It's not as critical that both doors be closed, especially during the summer months, if there's a need to get circulation. It's primarily the rear door, which is the door that's closest to the abutting residential, in both cases that would be the concern.
In the, if I read this right, the front door, when it's open at 40 feet, is still only 78.5 decibels. So we're not talking much more than traffic, if we are talking more. Any further questions of the applicant? Thank you, Mr. Rosner.
Thank you.
Would there be anyone in the audience that would like to address this item? And we, in this one in specific, we'd be talking about the Crawford and 9th Street location. A little quieter than the last time in 92, I guess. Any further discussion?
Do we need both of these, or can we do them together?
Well, I think that they're separate agenda items, so we need to do these separately. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept application Z92-6A.
And stated. And did you want to use the staff recommendations in the supplemental report?
Yes.
And what about the front door being opened in the times when the weather is above 45 degrees?
I'm fine with that.
That was your motion?
So, yeah, we will clarify that by inserting the word rear doors.
Okay. Second. Been moved and seconded to approve application, I'm sorry, Z92-6A, with the staff recommendations, and on item D, changing it to rear doors. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? None being heard, motion carries. Okay. Mr. Herz, same song, different dance, Z98-11A.
Yeah, you're exactly correct. It is very, very similar. The history is very, very similar. I think what we'll do is we'll dispense with some of the history simply because it is very similar, except for the fact that this Planning Commission approved the amendment to the future land use plan, the comprehensive plan, to allow for commercial on the eastern portion along Connecticut and Iron there. And as well as the rezoning classification. And the City Commission concurred with the Planning Commission on the amendment to the comp plan, but did not concur with the rezoning to just regular C5 zoning, and requested that the applicant go back to the Planning Commission and with a to propose a planned commercial district. And so that's what we're with here today, is a planned commercial district. Originally, the conditions of approval that the Planning and City Commission approved, and eventually on August 17th, 1998, were that development shall be limited to the car wash, convenience store, gasoline service station, fast food restaurant, plus other uses limited and permitted in the C3 district. The building setback from Connecticut Avenue shall be not less than 15 feet. Vehicular access shall be obtained only from Ohio Street and Iron Avenue, and the new 30-foot driveway on Iron shall be separated from the existing driveway distance of 22 feet between the curbs. And exterior lighting fixtures shall not cast any direct light to the east or south, and the development of the site, including the building design, landscaping, shall substantially conform to the approved site development plan. And as with the last plan, with the other site, Casey's is not proposing any changes to any of those items. All of those items would still be in place as they are. All of the facade changes that they're proposing have already taken place in the way of the new signage with the new logos that you'll see when you drive by, converted from the old Green Lantern logos that were there before. So the changes are completely limited to the overhead doors and the inside dryers. So I think at this point, all of the same questions would exist with the decibels. But if there's any other questions or discussion, we can open up to those thoughts.
Any questions of staff?
Dustin, would it be reasonable to say in this instance the same could hold true, that the rear door would be the one that would be most in or benefit the neighbors the most?
I think so, since that would be the if that's what we're going to do on the other one, I think being consistent and having that as our operation would be fine, would be acceptable.
This is not apropos to what we're talking about, but it looks to me like the landscaping that was approved is not in fact in place. In other words, I don't see the trees along Connecticut that...
Are they in that jutting end of the fence there, immediately east of the building? There is landscaping in that recess. I don't know what was originally...
There's like an aerial, kind of an aerial view, or not an aerial view, but at least, yeah.
This here?
Right.
There's a tree here.
Bushes and trees.
Yeah, but... The approved plan shows trees in the strip between the sidewalk and Connecticut.
You're talking this area?
Yes. Which also acts as a buffer that I assume was figured in originally.
Yeah, just some history on that buffer. What they've done there is, because of the distance of the right-of-way, it's actually 70 feet on Connecticut, when normally on a residential street like that, we would have 60 feet of right-of-way, mm-hmm. which effectively gives us 5 extra feet of quasi-buffer area on each side. So even though that 5 extra feet is in the right-of-way, it was concluded that that extra 5 feet would be a benefit to the private property, even though it's green area in the right-of-way, so to speak. In other words, this distance here is wider than what you would normally have if along a residential street. Now, I can't speak as to why there are no trees there and the tree count. We didn't survey or go out and inventory any of that information for you. We just, assumed that the plan that was approved was still in effect, but we haven't checked it.
Okay. I'm going to be counting trees.
John, I don't know what the drawing is, but it'll be one of the drawings that was, I guess it's this one here.
Right.
And I believe you're, do you have the, you're referring to the fact that this tree's not there and these trees don't appear to be there. From looking at the aerial photos, there appeared to be perhaps stumps there, so they could be ice storm victims or things of that nature, but that's something that we can follow up on. But I can tell you that there were trees there at one time.
Okay, so they maybe need to be replaced.
Yes, they could have been. If they were Bradford pears or things of that nature, then they probably didn't survive the ice storm.
Got it.
Any further questions of staff?
But the buffer areas are all still the same. Okay. That we did check.
Would the applicant like to add anything to this?
We purchased this property on December 9th, and we did not remove any trees. So anything that was gone has been died out over the course of years. So that part of it, I really don't know.
I know somebody you can talk to.
Look at that. Yes, I know there's several there without leaves, but and I do know there's a lot of shrubs, but I really don't know the condition of any of them or that type of stuff. So,
thank you. Anyone in the audience care to address this application? And again, we're talking at the location of Iron and Ohio. None being seen. Bring this back to the commission for action.
I'd make a motion that we approve the application similar to the conditions in the previous application, with the one door being closed during operation and the door facing the Iron Street site to remain open during the operation in the summer.
Is there a second?
Second.
Been moved and seconded to approve application Z98-11A.
Oh, 11, if I'm on the wrong one, sorry.
With the same conditions as the last one, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? None being heard, motion carries. Okay, we are to item number 7 on our agenda. Application Z10-3 filed by Delwin Newman requesting an amendment of Article 4 General Use Regulations, Section 42-60, Home Occupations, Subsection 3A, particular home occupations prohibited to allow automotive window tinting as permitted home occupation in residential zoning districts, and requesting an amendment of Article 4 General Use Regulations, Section 42-60, Home Occupations, Subsection 4D, to allow the Board of Zoning Appeals to approve automotive window tinting as a home occupation that can be conducted in a detached garage. Dean?
Mr. Herz will have the background report here for you.
I think we'll start with looking at how our home occupation ordinance is currently organized and how we administer it. The first section deals with all of the restrictions and limitations that we have on home occupations. The way home occupations work is there are certain businesses that we do allow that, as long as they don't conflict with the character, the residential characteristic of the residential neighborhoods, we find them to be acceptable. The particular uses that are currently allowed are, go to section 2 if you would, John, so we can look at that, just so they have an idea. These are the particular uses that are currently allowed. Teachers having a limited amount of students, so it's like a tutor, or we had a tutor a couple years ago that came and wanted to do this, and daycares, artists who work out of their homes, or authors that work out of their homes. Barbershops, if you have one chair. Barbershops with one chair are about the only, one of the very few permitted uses that we allow that have people coming to the site. Most of the other times it's just something, it's of an office use or nature where there is no traffic being generated and people aren't coming to the residence. It's just used as a office facility. In other words, some contractors will have a home occupation for the office use. In other words, they'll have a wife, if it's a husband and a spouse who have a contracting business, the husband will go out and go to the various sites and do the work, and the wife will stay home and take care of the invoices and take the calls. They could get a office use there, but none of the contracting equipment is to be stored on the site, and you don't have any employees reporting to the site as a contracting facility. So it's very limited in what can and cannot be used. It's more of a privilege than a right, per se, like you would have in a normal commercial or industrial zoning classification, because it is secondary to the residential use of the property. The particular request at hand by the applicant is an amendment to subsection 3 right here that you'll see. I'll clean it up. Automobile and other motor vehicle repairs, as those would be considered prohibited. And the way that that has historically been interpreted is that anything that deals with the automobile, whether it be changing oil, changing tires, anything that pertains to the automobile, if it's far from automobile service to automotive repair, has been disallowed or not permitted or prohibited. So that is a requested change that the applicant has, as they want to have an exception written into this prohibition to allow for window tinting. And the applicant will get up later and explain more about the procedures. But as we understand it, what they're wanting to do is have a kind of a plastic film that they apply to car windows to, tint the windows. And so there aren't any chemicals that you wouldn't usually find in the home. What we have been told is that soap is used as the only solution, and a hairdryer, I believe, and a squeegee. But they'll go into more details on that. Along with amending that section, they are proposing an amendment to section 4. As you will notice by looking through what is allowed and permitted, one of the things that is prohibited is that all home occupations have to be located within the residential dwelling unit, with the exception of these three situations that are currently allowed, A, B, and C, and those are required to have Board of Zoning Appeals approval. And all of those that A, B, and C are allowing businesses that are not normally allowed inside of a residence. In other words, the small engine repair, including the lawnmowers, is an activity that couldn't be done inside of a residence. So what they were proposing to do is add a D to that. So underneath small engine repair, you would have automotive window tinting with whatever conditions or stipulations and limitations that you would want on there. I think currently the way they have the words and the verbiage that's been proposed by the applicant is somewhat of a draft, and they would seek your guidance on if you're interested in this type of text amendment, or if you're not interested, and if you are interested, what kind of language needs to be added or subtracted to what they've proposed.
Any questions of staff?
Just looking at this permitted and not permitted, H is professional office for physician and dentist, and then under prohibited is C, medical or dental clinics. So clinics meaning more than one doctor, and the other is just a single practice?
All of the home occupations are limited to a resident of that dwelling unit.
Right.
So you can't have any employees reporting to your site of business, and that's why it's limited to either one physician or one barber, and that one physician or one barber has to be a resident. So yes, you are correct in the assumption that clinic insinuates that you would have more than one physician, and in this case you would only be allowed to have one physician.
Now, am I to understand from the information that we got in our packet, Is there currently window tinting going on at this residence?
Not currently. I think there's some history, and Dean can speak more of that than I can since I wasn't around at that particular point in time. But there was an instance when I believe there was, in which case the applicant was notified that that was not allowed, and has since then leased a commercial site to do the window tinting, and is wishing to take that window tinting business into the home. And that's the reasoning for this application, is so that that window tinting business that is now at a commercial site can be moved to the residence. But at one point in time, there was activity at the applicant's residence, which has ceased and desist since then.
And one of your comments earlier, you said one of the things that negatively would impact this would be people at the site, additional people at the site. Is it safe to say if people are bringing vehicles there to be worked on, there's going to be additional people at the site?
That is one of the, negative aspects of the application, is that it would require some sort of commercial activity in a residential area, even though all of these allowed home occupations allow a certain level of commercial activity. It's finding that fine line of what is permissible and what isn't, what adheres to the residential characteristic and what does not, what crosses the line. For instance, is it okay for a window tinting business to be a home occupation but not a gentleman who just wants to change tires or just wants to change oil? They're not creating any noise or having any negative impacts on the neighborhood in that fashion. So what's okay and what's not okay, but you're correct that you would have to have a certain level of traffic or people coming and going to the residence for the commercial activity to function the way it's supposed to.
And that generally, when we research this, I don't know what the count is up to, but it's over 20, different communities that we looked at, none of which allow any kind of automotive service or repair in a residential area, just because of that aspect, and then just the environmental or regulatory aspect of that if you have people doing body work on cars, they tend to do it at odd hours, which irritates neighbors. If they paint cars, they're not going to do it inside because you've got to have a ventilated paint booth. So then you've got potential for overspray going on to neighbors. So what the focus is here is the applicants have tried to carve out a very narrow exception to a general prohibition on any kind of automotive services in a residential neighborhood. And so just because we can't find another city that would allow it doesn't mean that you can't be creative to carve out that exception, but there are two reasons for that. One is you can't work on cars inside a house, and the second reason is most of the time when you're working on cars, that means additional cars in the driveway or the street or additional traffic, and those are two things that potentially have impacts on neighboring properties. It would be the traffic impact as well as any environmental impact. And so it does require Board of Zoning Appeals action to do anything that's going to take place outside of the house. So for example, we've had a number of cases where somebody wants to put a beauty shop inside their detached garage. In order to do that, requires notifying the neighbors and having the Board of Zoning Appeals review that, just because that the outbuildings tend to be less sound insulated. They also tend to be located closer to neighbors than the house itself, and so it can have some impacts that way. So that is the safeguard there, but this is a general prohibition, and if you look back in the report, I think we've been providing written correspondence to the applicant since 1998 that this type of activity is not permitted in a residential district, and this is a there's a court order in place that currently prohibits it, so the only way to get around that is to change the ordinance so that this could be a permissible use.
I just want to clarify that this has been ongoing from the applicant since 1998?
That's correct, yes.
I have one more question for you. Were the applicant's neighbors notified of this application?
No, this is a general text amendment. It would apply citywide. And then if it were approved, there would be an application process for doing that. This, as you could see from the letter from Mr. Berger that's in your packets from 2004, it's basically informing the applicant that we can't issue a home occupation certificate for this type of use. And so if this text amendment were approved, it would go under the category that somebody could apply to do automotive window tinting at their residence. Neighboring property owners would be notified, and there would be a hearing before the Board of Zoning Appeals to consider whether that should be approved. But as the ordinance stands today, you couldn't even apply to do it.
Okay. Any further questions of staff? Would the applicant care to address the commission? Your name and address, please.
Lisa and Del Newman, we live at 805 Sherman here in town. It seems like we have a theme with the locations of all the things today. We're in the same neighborhood. I thought I'd provide a little insight into what tenting consists of. And he tents commercial buildings, we tent homes. Automotive is just a part of that. So obviously when we do commercial or homes, we're going to off-site. But in the event that we have an automobile, then they would come to our place. Tenting consists of applying a film that has a plastic coating that you peel off to the inside of a window using baby shampoo and water. Film is measured and then cut with an X-Acto knife to fit whatever the window size is. The window is then squeegeed out with just a wooden plastic squeegee. A hairdryer or heat gun is sometimes used to help that drying process. So again, all these items are just common household items that would be used, solely used, if we were approved for the garage. There is no need for storage or anything that would be put in our backyard or aside the house or anything like that. There's no need to put anything outside, whether it's inventory or equipment or anything of that nature. Obviously, we're dealing with X-Acto knives and squeegees, very small things, and inventory is very manageable. Nothing is hazardous or flammable about tenting in a home, a business, or in a garage or a car. There's no sound with window tenting to affect any neighbors. It actually has to be very sterile and very clean. And so if this was approved and he was able to tent in the garage, doors would be closed. No one, in essence, would really even know what was going on. In terms of the vehicle tenting, you only tent one car at one time. And one car, a four-door car, can take up to 4 hours. And the way that his practice has always been is it's a drop-off. And so in terms of thinking about traffic or customers, and even at the shop that we have, people drop off their cars, and either someone picks them up, sometimes on rare occasions he'll take them somewhere, but even at the shop, very rarely people wait because it's a timely process. And so they always kind of make arrangements to either be taken back to work or to go whatever, and then when we're done, we call them, and they come and pick up their car and off they go. So in terms of traffic or in terms of people, you know, what they do if they drop their vehicle off at our house, for the most part, it is a drop-off. And then in terms of thinking about the time element of a car to be tented for 4 hours, that really limits the amount of cars that he's able to do in a day, you know, in one day. And as a side note, this is something that we do on the side. We both have full-time jobs. So when we were thinking about this, we gave very careful consideration and planning in what this would be like if someone wanted to come before the city and wanted to do this full-time, which Dell will tell you that there's not a lot of window tenters out there. It's a very specialized, humbling practice. So there's not that worry that the city's going to be flagged with window tenters everywhere. I'm just trying to think. We had provided the city, we've been talking with the city, communicating with them for the last year. In addition to the long history, we've researched other communities that have somewhat similar, not pertaining to window tinting, but attached garage plans, and that's kind of how we came up with the premise of the amendment language and the very measurable language that's in there. I'm trying to think if I missed anything else. Do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I was going to touch on some of the stuff that they said. You know, as far as traffic, no matter if it's a barber shop or small engine repair or whatever, there's always going to be vehicles and people coming and going. I mean, that's just commonplace with any type of a deal like that. And like Lisa said, I usually do maybe one or two cars a day, so it's very limited. My driveway will hold 3 to 4 cars alone. So I mean, if you were driving by my house, you may think somebody's over watching a movie or football game. I mean, it's, in my opinion, it would be very, the traffic would be very minimal, not disruptive. Like she said, when we do it, I'll be inside the garage, doors closed, my garage is heated and air conditioned, and you can't do window tinting outside. I mean, it has to be really sterile. We have no employees. I have no intentions of having anybody work for me. It's a real, it's real tedious, and there's, like she said, if there's not a lot of window tinters out doing it. I mean, I've been doing it about 15 years. It takes a long time to get good at it. So a lot of people may think they want to do it, and then they just, you know, walk away from it because it's pretty humbling. Also, I came from an automotive background. I went to a General Motors school. That's pretty much what my forte has been in the past. I was a technician for about 15 years. So the grouping as far as automobile repair and stuff and or repainting, refinishing, I don't know if that's a fair analogy of window tinting at all, because you know, there's no hazardous chemicals, no loud tools, no emitted noise. So it's kind of a real specialized profession, I guess.
Do you want to say anything about talking to the neighbors that you've asked them in the past?
Or? Yeah, and my neighbors, I mean, they were all really shocked that originally when I had told them I was going to do that, they were really shocked that I had to get a shop someplace else to do it. And the deal with the shop in regards to that, because of the low volume we do, like right now we rent a huge shop. To have one or two cars in it at a time, and to try to heat that, you know, keep it cool. It has to be really a certain temperature to tint windows also. So trying to keep something that of that size heated, cooled, and all that, it's just, it would be a great benefit if I could do it back at my home in my own shop, where I can have a lot more control over the environment also. But we've also been getting into more of the commercial and residential stuff, where we go on site and do it, and we also do go to dealerships and stuff like that and do cars right there on site for them also. So
in essence, too, it's nice to be able to have the business in the home, in the aspect of the scheduling, the invoicing, the billing that we do on that end as well, to have everything in just one hub.
Further questions of the applicants?
So you would move your whole business to your home? So everything would be located in your home, and you would not have an off-site for the other tenting practices, correct?
Yeah, we would just, if we did the automotive, what we would have here, we would just do in our garage. Sure. As far as the commercial and everything, mm-hmm. we just do that, right? We don't remove the windows or anything, so right. we just would do that wherever the site may be.
I know that if this is passed here, then you would go before the Board of Zoning Appeals. So it's not necessarily apropos to this, but I went down Sherman and I was trying to figure out which was your house, and there were no numbers, and the numbering system is kind of strange there, so I couldn't tell which one was your home. So
well, we recently had new siding put on it, and we yeah. do not have numbers.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But you are correct, it is odd. We're the second house on the south from Frost and Sherman. It's a tan home right now.
And it's a detached or attached garage?
It's detached.
Okay.
And my garage sits way yeah. back from the street.
Okay.
And it's okay. it's like a 16 by 40.
Okay.
On the front, it just looks like a little tiny garage, but it's not.
Okay.
The window tinting industry is starting to use a lot of mechanized pre-cut materials that require the use of plotters and computer programs and stuff to generate the films. Do you have plans of getting that equipment?
We've thought about it. The problem with a lot of those plotters is windows, if you guys are all familiar with cars usually, as they get older, the windows tend to rock sometimes when you roll them down. They'll move front to back. Those plotters don't know that. They're a set cut, so a lot of times with the plotters, if you get a vehicle where that window shifts a little bit, you get a lot of gap, and it's kind of a 50-50. We may go with a plotter sometime. I don't know. They're very expensive, and like I said, there's ups and downs to having those. We've looked at them before, but I don't know. It just kind of depends on how the business goes from here. Maybe we'd look into that later.
Are you proposing the draft language, or do we see that at some point? Or?
Well, what the draft language is kind of on page one of your report there for this item, and what they're looking at is there's a general prohibition in the current regulations that says prohibited. Particular home occupations prohibited, automobile and other motor vehicle repair and painting services. They're proposing to add a phrase to that says, which would be finalized to say that except for automotive window tinting, specifically permitted or allowed for in subsection D. And what you have in subsection D is that you can, if you wanted to repair lawnmowers in your garage for your neighbors, you could do that. You could apply to do that, and there would be notification of your neighbors. And if they were not objecting and the Board of Zoning Appeals believed it be conducted in a way that it wouldn't have an adverse effect on neighboring properties, then they could approve that. So what they're proposing here is to carve out an exception to the general prohibition, which would remain in place. So you'd still have a general rule that says automobile and other motor vehicle repair and painting services is still prohibited. So somebody wants to mend fenders or paint cars in a residential area, that would still be prohibited, but it would create an exception which would allow them to apply to the Board of Zoning Appeals for their Sherman location. Neighbors would be notified, the Board of Zoning Appeals would have a hearing, and if they considered that this could be conducted in a way that it wouldn't have an adverse effect on neighbors, then they could get a home occupation certificate to do that through the Board of Zoning Appeals. But there are two amendments which we would work to finalize. One would be to the item under section 3 there that has the prohibition, and then the second one would be in section 4 that would allow the language that says a home occupation certificate may be issued by the Board of Zoning Appeals for the following uses if the board finds in its review that the proposed use will not have an adverse effect on neighboring property owners. And then you would have a subset D there that says automotive window tinting conducted in a completely enclosed structure. And then these items that deal with a number of, by appointment and scheduling and no outdoor storage, those were things that would be addressed by the board on a case-by-case basis. So basically the situation they're in today, they, because of past decisions, they cannot even apply to do this today without a change in the code. And so they're asking to carve out an exception within the general prohibition. The general prohibition would still remain in place, and this would be a singular exception to that. And so I guess my only caveat to that, the burden for Mr. Herz and or myself would be that we would have to have an agreed upon definition of what auto window tinting is and what it isn't, that it's a very narrow category of what it is.
Let me ask you one more question. Do you do other things besides window tinting?
No, it's strictly just window tinting.
Somebody came and asked you to polish a car at the same time?
No.
No detailing, no stereos.
That's another thing with window tinting. If you're familiar with painting or anything like that, waxes, anything like that, that's bad. It's just like being in a paint. It has to be really, really sterile.
Well, I have to tell you, and if you're asking us to look at this from, and I am sympathetic to your plight, absolutely. But if you're asking us to look at this on a on an amendment basis, I would have a hard time not thinking that other people would be doing this at all hours of the night, and you know, there's a lot of variables that you're introducing there, and asking you I would think would be probably the tip of the iceberg in terms of being finite in what you do. I think a lot of other people, if they had the ability to do this at their home, would take on other jobs like doing an oil change or doing a detail or doing a polish job or something like that. But that's what this board has to decide, is what's in the best interest of your neighbors, so to speak. So
you're
always the devil's advocate here. But
yeah, I think we have to keep reemphasizing that the general prohibition is in place. So if somebody's out there changing oil or installing car stereos or detailing or things like that at a residence, it's still a violation.
Is your department going to be the window tinting cops and go around and
have been for 11 years?
My only comment here, if I may,
absolutely.
If we've got an exception for lawn mower repair, we will let somebody repair lawn mowers in their garage, and we won't allow them to tint. That seems out of balance. I don't disagree with your comments. We do have to play devil's advocate here. However, when I saw lawnmower repair, these two don't seem to coincide. I would much rather have somebody in my neighborhood tinting than repairing lawnmowers.
I have to agree with that, knowing that the lawnmower repair shop I use is on 9th on Iron Street. I don't know if anybody goes to Mr. Radke. I don't know if he has a permit for that.
Oh, great.
It's allowable.
He's just cooked his goods.
It's allowable. I mean, probably
right, but I have to keep reemphasizing that it is discretionary. In other words, if somebody applied to do auto window, if you approve this and somebody applied, the Board of Zoning Appeals can always say no. Mm-hmm. And it also requires that neighbors be notified so they have a chance to weigh in. And that's the extra safeguard. If somebody does a beauty shop in their house, neighbors aren't notified, we just sign a certificate that says you can do this beauty shop in your home. But these special provisions here, if somebody wants to do this lawnmower repair or have a bed and breakfast, or one that was done that's at the corner of Ash and Ohio that sometimes spills out of bounds, is small engine repair that is golf carts. And there's a golf cart repair business that was approved by the Board of Zoning Appeals at Ash and Ohio.
And they have a lot of traffic.
They have more traffic. The thing about the difference between lawnmowers or small engines is that generally they easily fit within the garage and you close the door, and it's just anything that's automotive related, cars tend to take up space and have parking, but it can be regulated in that way by appointment and limited hours.
So how does staff feel about opening this up to automotive issues?
Well, our world's much cleaner if it's just plain that if it's anything automotive related, it's right. Not permitted. But you have to do what Mr. Birdsong was talking about and weigh that and what's noisier, revving up lawnmowers or applying window tinting. It has more to do with, as much to do with ease of administration, and the reason you can look at 20 communities and they all prohibit automotive services because it's easier to do that than to to go in and define the different subsets of that. So
I really don't have any problem with it, and I commend the couple for coming in and, you know, asking for the exception. We're not going to open the floodgates to window tinting in Salina, Kansas with this text amendment.
Global warming, you know.
I think just one thing, and I appreciate you coming in, but one of the annoyances in residence is car doors slamming, cars coming and going. Some have louder pipes than you would expect most cars to have, and as a resident, that's one of the, it's not the job you're doing in the garage, it's the cars coming and going. And if you look at your property, and I'll compliment you, your house is beautiful there, but but if you look at the front of your house, if you have three or four cars there at a time, you're really going to, I would think that you would need to park some of them in front of the neighbors. To some people, that's an annoyance too. Maybe not to your current neighbors, but to some other people that may move in, that's an annoyance. So I just want to bring that out, that it's not about the job you're doing in the garage. I think it's the overall picture of cars coming and going from a residence for business purposes. For with lawnmowers, it's kind of a similar thing in that you bring them in a pickup, but the pickup leaves and you leave the lawnmower as opposed to a car. And I don't know that you will, but having been involved with automobiles a time or 2 months, sometimes you have a tendency to work on them late at night, and then you may slam the door. Regular hours would be critical, and those would have to be written in.
Because that's 7:30 to 10. Is that Monday through Friday or 7 days a week?
Well, and I can maybe address that a little bit too, so you won't have to worry about the hours. I work nights. I work for the Union Pacific Railroad, so I work 11 to 7.
But those type of specific questions would be for the Board of Zoning Appeals.
Right, they would tailor that through the actual permit on a case-by-case, location-by-location basis.
But is it 7 days a week?
Yes.
From 7:30 to 10? Okay. Mm-hmm.
And I was just going to say, one of the measurable factors that we did was how many cars, because we wanted to recognize that concern that would be there, and that it would be, you know, one to three, or... And with them coming and dropping off, you know, that picture right there could be where he's, you know, tenting, and no one would ever know if he pulls the car in and they drop off and leave. We wanted to be real purposeful about having a measurable amount of clients that we can see per day, so that there's not a parking issue or people are in the street at all. We're trying to be aware of that.
Two cars will fit in that garage.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
I'd approve it just because you seem so smart.
We're taking this very seriously.
Yes, you are.
And Dell has lived in this home for almost 15 years, and he has connections with the neighbors. The neighbors to, I don't know my directions, the south, have been there for 20-some years. The people across the street have been there 30. They know our plight, the good, the bad, and the ugly, and are supportive. And we try not to hold any secrets, and I wouldn't want to live next to someone that is going to make my life miserable. And so everything that we've been trying to think about was, would we want to live next to these people, or you know, so we're trying to be very serious in our steps.
I admire you going through the proper channels and having the stick-to-itiveness to pursue this for 12 years. That's incredible.
Miss, I have six teenagers, and if anybody wants to gripe about car doors in the middle of the night, I'm the first guy to come and see.
Well, if we're taking this at face value, what is written before me is something that I don't see that I can be against. I understand surrounding concerns. However, this has been written specifically, and with due respect to the staff, yes, automotive, that if we stay on one side or the other, that's very clean. But again, what's written in front of me is very clear-cut and very approvable.
Excuse me, just one second. Is there any further questions of the applicant?
I think that's
okay.
It.
You appear to be ready to make a motion.
Would move that accept the application. As specified in the staff report.
With the language that's proposed.
What Dean was talking about.
That would address that in an actual application and action.
Right, this is just
but for the there would be a two-part amendment. One section and then amending a section that lists uses that you can do in a detached structure. That will be very simple.
Been a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? No. Alyssa? No.
Thank you.
Other matters?
If it is, since we're already past that hour now, if it's agreeable to you for the what we would look to do on March 2nd would be to invite various stakeholders, developers, landowners, whatever, have a full public hearing on the proposed comprehensive plan, but scheduled to start that in the evening at 6:30 and not have any regular business at for 4 o'clock at all and simply focus on that. There was some discussion that perhaps we would get better attendance and participation if it could be scheduled in that evening time, and it seemed to work pretty well with our floodplain meetings because we probably had about 400 to 500 people at the 6:30 session.
Wow.
That's what I said. Sorry. I was asking. It seems like a million.
Okay. Yeah, between the two of them, it's probably well over that. But
does that fit in everybody's schedule?
That worked for. Well, we'd.
However?
What's that?
Are we proposing the meeting here on the 2nd?
Yes, it would be in this room.
Not
but
the Bison.
Yeah, we wouldn't need that full area there. We don't have near as many interested parties in that as we do in the floodplain stuff. So, but we would have a targeted audience that we would want to notify and let them have a chance. Well, I would also want, we would do a background report, give you options for action, but if there's anything that's still an uncertainty or unknown, it's an adoption public hearing, but that you always have the option of continuing that or asking that something be modified, clarified, specified, whatever that might be. It's mostly to have that formal hearing where development community and landowners can speak to it and you can listen to what they have to say.
Great.
Which is a statutory requirement before you adopt something.
And unless they'll send us multiple reminders. And
we would.
Yeah.
Formally adopt.
Great.
But that, again, we have been nothing at 4, and we would have nothing else on your agenda except for the plan itself.
So our official meeting would be at 6:30 that day?
Yes.
Yes.
It'd be a regular March 2nd meeting, but at a different time and only one subject.
Very good. If there's no other business, we are adjourned.